Buah, buah. Muy buenas, Wargames. Aquí estamos otra vez con el gran maestro Alessio Cavatore. Muy buenas, Alessio.
Hello.
Buongiorno, good morning.
Hola.
También, también está con nosotros Rorco, obviamente.
¿Qué tal, gente?
Y bueno, vamos a hablar un poquito de todo lo que hace de referencia, sobre todo a temas de Loka y el nuevo tarot de Loka, algo que Alessio se sacó de la chistera. Nadie sabía nada. Y además vamos a comentar algunas cosillas sobre King of War, de las que nos habéis preguntado, y yo mismo, como fan de King of War, que me gustaría saber. Y vamos a empezar. Creo que ya sabes, Alessio, que hace un par de semanas hicimos un torneo en Málaga de King of War. Y la pregunta que todo el mundo se hacía en el aire era si quizás, como se había dicho en los foros, Mantic estaba preparando una especie de nuevo Kickstarter para King of War, porque en el libro de Basilea hay dos ejércitos más, aparte de Basilea. Está la fuerza de la naturaleza y las del abismo, y aún Mantic no se ha pronunciado nada sobre esas tropas. Lo único, hay una foto con las miniaturas de Loka que quedan genial en King of War. ¿Puedes decir algo sobre eso, Alessio? ¿Qué planes hay para sacar esos dos ejércitos? Que la gente los quiere, Alejandro. Alessio, Alejandro, todo el mundo los quiere.
Okay. Some weeks ago, we made a tournament in Malaga about Kings of War, and a lot of people ask about the two other armies that are also in the book of Basilea, and ask it if there will be a Kickstarter about these two armies because there aren't any miniatures, and Mantic hasn't spoken a lot about them. The only pictures we have, it's already some of the Locust miniatures used as reference for these two armies. Will we see soon a Kickstarter about these two armies or have some news about them, Alessio?
Well, I don't know about a Kickstarter. I mean, surely Mantic, I think at some stage will have to do another Kings of War Kickstarter, I'm sure. How they're going to shape it, how are they going to organize it, and how much of these armies will, be part of it, I don't know. I honestly don't know. And that's a question for Ronnie rather than for me. But from my point of view, there are things that I'm doing towards making those other two armies a reality. So maybe I'll let you translate this bit, and then I'll tell what the other bits I'm doing are.
Vale. Me va a hablar por parte. Bueno, dice que él no sabe si va a haber un Kickstarter o no. Teóricamente tendrán que hacerlo más tarde o más temprano un Kickstarter sobre los dos ejércitos, pero él realmente no lo sabe y la persona en cuestión que habría que preguntarle eso sería Ronnie. Lo que sí que es, puede hablar son un par de cosas que él sí está trabajando ahora mismo en estos dos ejércitos, que me lo va a explicar ahora.
Pues
Eso.
adelante.
See, there are two new expansions that I'm working on for Kings of War. I've taken a little break after the holidays working on Kings of War, and now I'm back into Mantic doing this. And there are two projects, which we kind of hinted already in other conversations, but I can be more clear now. Is basically one is that Ronnie has a passion for dwarves.
I know, Alessio, I know.
He likes dwarves. So one of the projects that I'm working on is to do with dwarves, both the good dwarves and the bad dwarves. And there will be some dwarf on dwarf action, I think. So.
One little question, una pequeña pregunta. Hay un fan de Forja y Desván que nos preguntó hace tiempo, bueno, hice un vídeo diciendo que iba a hacer una entrevista contigo y si alguien tenía preguntas. Y una de las que había era de un fanático de los enanos que preguntaba si podría haber enanos con lanzas. Supongo que con la regla falange de Kingdom Hearts. ¿Es posible en esta nueva expansión de guerra de enanos?
Yes, it's possible. Oh, sorry, in English, of course.
Yes. Sorry for the interruption, but some weeks ago we made a live video where we
No,
asked
perdón,
people to
explicas.
make questions about Kings of War, about this interview, and there was one real fanatic about dwarves, and he asked if the dwarves will have spears in the future with the Phalanx rule.
I think it's likely. I think it's quite possible. I cannot be 100% sure, but I think it's highly likely.
Dice que sí, que no es seguro, pero que posiblemente sí.
Okay. So.
Okay. You were talking about the project about the two dwarves, the good ones and the bad ones. Continue.
Yeah, that is one project. If anything, that's kind of the smallest or the smaller of the two projects. The other one, yes, is going to be one of those armies that are in the Basilean book, the other two armies. And obviously, quite a lot of people really went to Mantic and went, oh, we want a full army. You know, it's basically the Denethor army and the Abyss armies are both kind of teasing, really, and people wanted more because they liked the Basileans, they liked the way the Basilean background and army and models were brought together. So there was a big demand of more of those other two armies. And we picked one of those two armies, and they will get, you know, their book, a bigger book with basically we do a Basilean job on one of those two armies. Now, which one of those two armies? I think I'll leave it as a suspense.
Okay.
But one of those two armies will grow bigger, yes.
Okay.
We'll get bigger, we get to a Basilean level. Jobby.
Okay.
Do you want to guess which one?
Oh, I don't know. One is really advanced and the other one is really small and has few units, so I don't know. I would really like to see also the nature one, because I am a wolf and animal geeks. So I like these armies. So for me, it will be better than nature. And the other one looks also fine.
I play with Eva Celian.
Do you want to translate my answer back in Spanish?
Yes. Vamos a ver. Dice que sí, que hay planeado dos expansiones, ¿vale? Después de las vacaciones, pues empezó otra vez a retomar el trabajo que estaba realizando y empezó a trabajar en la primera expansión, que sería la de los enanos, que se centraría sobre tanto en los enanos buenos como en los malos, algún tema relacionado con entre ambos. Y luego también tiene otro proyecto mucho más grande entre manos, que es otro libro de expansión, de los que ya hay. Lo que ha pasado es que la gente le ha gustado tanto los ejércitos, pues que ha ido a Mantic pidiéndole que saquen otro libro de ejércitos ya más completito a nivel de los de Basilea, de los otros dos ejércitos que ya presentaron, las Fuerzas de Naturaleza y el Abismo. Entonces ahora mismo se van a poner a trabajar en uno de esos dos, no van a decir cuál es, lo van a dejar así un poquito en suspense, y lo van a llevar a nivel del libro de Basilea. Me ha preguntado a mí cuál pensaba yo que iba a ser, y yo le digo que en verdad no lo sé, el de la misma está menos desarrollado, pero a mí personalmente me gusta más el tema de las naturalezas, porque soy un friki de los lobos y todas esas cosas, los animales.
Es mucho más original.
He says that the nature one is more original, not so much seen.
Well, the theme of the elements is something that, as you know, I am quite keen on, and certainly I like the elemental links with the nature army. Yes, but we'll see. Basically, I'm not saying that we are going to do. Sorry, when I say we, I mean Mantic. Mantic are going to do one and not the other. What I'm saying is certainly one will be done first, and then the other.
Bueno, Alessio dice que le gusta más el tema de la naturaleza, obviamente por todas las referencias que pueda tener respecto
¡Gnomos! ¡Gnomos
a
ataque!
Loca
¡Gnomos!
y demás, pero no está diciendo que se vaya a hacer eso primero. La decisión es de Mantic, así que puede ser o no, que eso ya depende. Alessio, but if you do, you will do the Nature Army, you will put some local reference, I think, so any jokes or Easter eggs in the rule book, aren't you?
That would be funny, yes, I think we should, yes.
Dice que sería divertido y que a lo mejor sí debería.
Las miniaturas de Loca son geniales para representar la fuerza de la naturaleza.
Loca miniatures are really great for representing the force of nature.
Loca style.
Yes.
Certainly, they are not really miniatures. They're more like chess pieces. But some of them, yes, are really good enough that they can be used in a war game if you paint them properly. Yes, and the I didn't know that they were going to put them in the book. You know, because I said put a picture here with some models that can represent this. I really didn't know. And then when I saw the at Mantic, when I went to Mantic and I saw the picture they've taken for illustrating the army, there was a Loka models, and I was like. Well, that was, it was a nice surprise. I like that.
Yes, this is also some instant publicity. You show.
This picture.
So I have to click on you, Remy Lenser. Okay.
Right.
If I click on you, I get the screen. Yeah, there's that.
Bien.
There's they actually poke into quite a few other pictures, if I remember
Sí.
correctly.
Alessio, it's a very great picture. You can see three werewolves
Yep.
versus a one centaur and woman tree.
Yep.
And the other picture is
Definitely.
this one.
Well, there's this one. Yeah, exactly.
Mm.
I was going to say that one has quite a few elementals behind her.
I think they get really well in the fluff of Kings of War, the design. So.
Yeah, and the painting is actually by the same people that paint the model. So actually, there is a
Salamanders. I need so many salamanders.
The Golden Painting Studio makes really a nice job with a lot of miniatures.
Yes.
And we have a quite good friends there in Golden Painting Studio, so we know that. And had a
Definitely.
lot of fun on the last Mantic Open Day we went on September 2012.
Are you coming to the next Kickstarter? Sorry, to the next open day on the end of this month?
No,
No,
we
they can't.
can't. We would really like, but we can't.
Because in Málaga, Spain, Málaga, the 7th and 8th of December, we made a Hispania War Games. It's a very great, very big event of miniatures in Spain. So many enterprises come here, so many tournaments. Flames of War, Warhammer 40K, King of War, the national. We promoted it with the Eminence distribution. So many tournaments, and we cannot
And there will be also
go to the Mantic Open Day.
some demonstration from Bolt Action, for example, and other games. There are
Cool.
a lot of stuff.
Cool.
Vale, voy a traducir lo que ha dicho. Dice que en realidad no serviría mucho porque son piezas de ajedrez. Creo que le sorprendió muchísimo cuando le comentó poner aquí una imagen o algo en esta página del libro, y cuando vio que realmente le habían sacado fotos a las miniaturas de Loca con la de Kings of War, pues se le cayó directamente la mandíbula como hizo en vídeo. Ah, mira, está enseñando
I have a
miniaturas.
bag. I have a bag full of them.
Mira, tiene una bolsa llena de ellas.
So we have green
I
miniatures.
hate you, Alessio. I hate you.
They look really clean.
It feels very much, when you take them and smell them and touch them, they are very remind you of those board game pieces that you get from Fantasy Flight level board games. So really cool, nice plastic, all one piece. So you can see, you know, slightly there is a little give. And they are in color, so actually the fact that they are in the right color for the race.
Well, so bigger. Oh,
yeah. they do feel like the right.
I love it.
But they look nice on the table. They look nice on the table when they're all lined up. Yes. So you see, there is some flexibility in this plastic.
Yes.
But that means that obviously when you put them all on the table, they look nice and colorful, and then of course once you finish with them, bang, in the bag, gone.
Dice, no, no está mostrando la figura. Dice que está bastante bien, tiene un plástico bastante sólido, pero también lo suficiente flexible. Recuerda un poquito más al plástico que está utilizando Fantasy Flight en los últimos juegos. Son miniaturas que se pueden tocar mucho, aparte que son muy coloridas y quedan vistosas en mesa, y después, por el material que es en sí, pues se permite ahí guardar directamente en la bolsa sin ningún problema. Bueno, claramente si no está pintado.
De que no se rompe.
Vamos, que son bastante resistentes y que no se rompe.
Estaba pensando, hay varias personas, de hecho hubo otra pregunta sobre este tema en ese vídeo que yo lancé preguntas para Alessio. Que hay gente, yo sinceramente me encuentro entre ellas, que creemos que a King of War le falta algún sistema de campaña. ¿Sería posible verlo, Alessio?
On the questions, there were all the questions. One of them is this one. He asked if there will be a sort of campaign system in Kings of War. We think it would be also really nice to have some campaign system in Kings of War. Will it be?
Well, there is a little bit of a hint in the rule book, but of course, yes, we can. We can expand. Yeah, we can expand on it, and possibly one of these two books will have a little bit of that. Yes, we haven't quite decided 100% what these two books. You know, we know what the main subject of the books is going to be, but we haven't actually decided the detail of what goes exactly in the book. So there is a possibility. The idea of a campaign has been mentioned. So we'll see when we get to the final specifications, which will be soon. I mean, tomorrow I'm going to Mantic and we're going to discuss these books in detail. So, you know, basically, as I said before, I just come from a little holiday on Kings of War, and I'm now starting again. And one of the things, as well as these two books, by the way, well, actually, maybe it's better if you translate this, then I will go for the other thing we're doing for Kings of War.
Okay.
But basically the answer to that is we're considering the idea of some campaign-y stuff in one of these books.
Vale. Vale, Alessio Galatore dice que sí, que había ya unas pequeñas pistas en el libro anterior sobre que estaban indicando que posiblemente lo habría y que lo expandirían. No sabe en cuáles de los libros lo van a meter, incluso todavía no saben cuál va a ser el tema principal de cada libro ni cómo lo van a enfocar. Pero que sí, que existen las ideas, se ha hablado, se ha discutido algunas veces, ya lo que falta es concretar y cómo meterlo o no meterlo, en cuál meterlo, en ese es lo que queda. De hecho, mañana va a ser una reunión con Matic a hablar específicamente de estos dos libros que van a sacar ahora, próximamente. Así que, poco más, ahora seguirá ella contando más cosas sobre los libros. ¿Alessio?
Sí, sería muy interesante. Es una idea, little bit. Aprovechando el tema de una especie de guerra civil o de guerra de enanos, ver qué ejércitos se alían o se mantienen neutrales con las facciones y ver cómo cambia un poquito el mapa del mundo de King of War.
He says that using only a hands-on idea, using the book background of the two dwarves armies that are fighting, we could see how this war between the two dwarves impacting the rest of the world, what alliances it will make, and how the new magic map shapes.
Como por ejemplo, que los orcos se alíen definitivamente con los enanos del abismo y estos les puedan dar algún tipo de armas de proyectiles, que es la gran carencia de los orcos. Yo juego con orcos y lo sufro mucho, Alessio, el no tener máquinas de guerra.
Okay, he says maybe could the orcs make an alliance with the abyssal dwarves, and the dwarves could get some arrows or shooting weapons to the orcs, because something that's really missing by the orcs army are something to shoot, actually. Yeah. He plays with orcs and he suffered that.
Yes, I understand that. And yes, the answer to that is that the idea of the alliances and the campaign shaping the world sounds exciting, and yes, it's something that if we do the campaign stuff, we'll certainly look into. So that's one answer. So yeah, cool. That sounds like a good idea. The orcs getting missile weapons, actually, I think is a bad idea, because, sorry to say, because I like the fact that different armies have different strengths and different weaknesses, mm-hmm. So if everybody has got everything, then, you know, it doesn't really matter which army you play, they're just different flavor of the same thing. So I like to give them, you know, the fact, for example, they don't have a lot of ranged capability and war machines and anything like this is actually good. And on the other end, if you do want your missile fight to get a bit stronger, the natural ally for the orcs, of course, is the goblins. You would just go, all right, I'll have some goblin war machines. Or even, you can ally with the abyssal dwarves. I mean, by the rules, you can, because they're the same alignment, aren't they? So it's relatively easy. But as well, orc war machines, I think, I don't like the idea, because they are very, almost contradicting the background.
Insertion somewhere? Vale, voy a traducir esto. Bueno, contestando a una de las preguntas, el tema de la alianza, dice que sí, suena emocionante el tema este de poder hacer una alianza y demás, que seguramente trabajaría en algo de eso. Y respecto a los orcos...
This is my regiment of war chariot orcs, but in the background is a very big ship of orcs, and he crushed the other people.
Cool, but that is cool. That is arky, and that is not a war machine. It doesn't shoot, so it's great. It's absolutely fantastic. Yes.
I think lo voy a decir en español por el vídeo. Yo considero que las armas de proyectiles, tales como cañones, no le pegan a los orcos. Los orcos en King of War es el ejército que de base mejor pega de todo el juego, por el Crushing Strength 2. Pero sería interesante, hablando, es un deseo, que los enanos abisales les construyeran una máquina de guerra. Que esa máquina de guerra pudiera tener quizás algún lanzallamas. Más que cañones tradicionales como otras razas. Una gran diferencia con respecto a los demás. Donde yo juego, la mayoría de la gente juega como mínimo con tres máquinas de guerra. Y mis orcos, aunque yo gano partidas, sufro mucho. Sufro mucho, Alessio.
Okay. He showed the big chariot. He's one of the horde of chariots that he uses in his army. And he says that he more hinted to the idea that dwarves could make a really big chariot with a flamethrower, not really distance, but something that he could use and help more the army, because where he plays, the people use a lot of war machines, and they use three or more, and he suffers really when playing against them.
Yeah.
He thinks also that the orcs has really the strong part of the orcs, or that they hit with two, and they're really strong in short combat, but they lack some because of the war machine. Mm. But Alessio, I will translate shortly the last line you said before of me. So people knows. Respecto al tema de los orcos, dijo que era una mala idea porque lo bonito de King of War es que todos los ejércitos tienen sus fortalezas y sus debilidades. En el momento que todos los ejércitos empiezan a tener de todo, ya no es lo mismo. Entonces eso es una base del diseño que él está siguiendo. Por lo tanto, él sí lo ve así. Bien, en cada caso, si quieres tener algo de disparo, pues puede, los orcos se pueden aliar naturalmente, fácilmente, con los goblins y tener algo ahí de respaldo en máquina y demás. O incluso podrían, ya que lo permite, son de la misma alianza, los enanos, sin ningún tipo de problema, para paliar pues esa falta de ataque a distancia. So, finished, Alessio, you can...
Okay, a couple of things. First thing is, I really love that war machine you made, because it's very orcish, and also, it's very Kings of War, and it kind of illustrates the great thing about Kings of War, one of the great things about Kings of War, which is that you can make a diorama base to represent a unit and can go wild with it. Now, as long as the size of the unit is the same as a normal, if you just did it with normal models, the right thing, then it doesn't matter what's on it, and you can build these fantastic things like that. So that's a very good example of a Kings of War-ness. So that's one thing. Do you want to translate that?
Vale, dice básicamente que le encanta tu carro orco. Por una parte porque es muy, muy Kings of War, bueno, primero porque es muy orco, es un diseño muy orco, muy, muy de vamos a montarlo así.
I think, orc style,
y después también le gusta mucho porque es muy Kings of War. En la base de Kings of War, el permitirte hacer unas unidades, pues, en plan de como si fuera un diorama, ya que tienes, ¿cómo se dice?, el tamaño de las peanas, y en Kings of War todo el mundo sabe que no tiene bajas, pues tiene tú esa base, sí, y la usas directamente para...
Obviamente, es el tamaño correcto de 6 carros por regimiento.
Yeah.
Es el tamaño legal. Y la gente dice, no puedes jugar con eso por la línea de visión. Digo, oh, ok. Let's try. is the same.
Very cool.
Y de otro.
Very cool.
Okay, I was trying to say that some people say to him, you can't play with this because the side wheel, you can see actually what they are looking, so he takes only the top part away and you're not, you can. So, no problem with that, and when we play all the battlefields.
It's very good, very good.
Voy a decir...
Espérate que...
Ah, vale,
después. Que Alessio va a continuar una cosita.
Ah, okay.
Alessio, continue where you were.
Yeah, I don't know whether... But anyway, what I wanted to say, the other thing we're going to do for Kings of War, yes. If you're familiar with... what I'm doing for Warlord Games, on their forums, a post, which is called the Command Post, which effectively is the place where you go to find all the extra rules, official rules like errata, FAQs, but also new units, new rules, like fighting at night, or tournament rules, you know, the tournament pack. So it's kind of the place where all the official information goes, is basically everything that is published there is as legal, as official as anything that is published in paper. So it gets all the PDFs, all the official updates. So there is one place where you go and find all the official material on top of the published of the books. So I was doing that for Bolt Action, for Warlord, and starting now I will do the same for Mantic, for Kings of War. So we are going to create a space on their website where you effectively have all the errata, public, you know, the PDF downloadable material like the errata, maybe a campaign, I don't know, well, I still have to decide what else to put in there, but maybe new units, anything that needs to be official and, you know, tournament legal and everything, then goes in there. What we are doing at the moment is trying to decide what the place is going to be called, that thing, because one is a command post in Bolt Action, because that's like World War II, you know, it's a command post, and the post. So we need to find a name for the warlord, for the king, the war one.
Vale. Una cosa que él está haciendo para Warlord Games y el juego Volaction es en el foro, hay una entrada que se llama Command Post. Ahí va toda la información al mismo nivel de la oficial, tanto sean errata como nuevas unidades, como regla para torneo, todo lo que sea. Ahí, en esa entrada, es oficial y se puede utilizar al mismo nivel que el libro de reglas. Ahora planea hacer algo parecido en Kings of War y van a poner un apartado en la página web donde irá toda esa información al mismo nivel. Lo único que no tienen decidido hasta ahora es el nombre que le van a poner. O sea, todavía no tiene ningún nombre apropiado pues, para ese tipo de apartado en la página de Kings of War que se acerque más a la temática de Kings of War, porque obviamente la palabra command post o entrada de comando es más referente a la guerra de Volaction y demás.
Zap News. una última pregunta sobre Kill of War y ya pasamos a hablar de Eloka. Dado que el Reino de los Hombres es uno de los ejércitos mejores por su versatilidad y por las picas, veremos en ese post en el foro listas históricas para jugar con el increíble sistema de el juego de King of War.
Vale. The last question about Kings of War. The Kingdom of Man is one really for more versatile and good armies because the war picks and the weapons they are using. And he wants to know if in this new section we will see some armies from the historical armies for the Kingdom of Man. ¿Alguna regla te refería, no, Julio?
Sí, no, so el rules, Greeks, Romans, Samurais. es para aprovechar, por ejemplo, las fantásticas miniaturas de Warlord Games. De Hail Caesar en Kino War y viceversa.
It's because of using the incredible, amazing miniatures of Warlord Games, like Hail Caesar or other historical miniatures. So some army lists he's talking about also.
You're talking about army lists, as in some specific kingdoms of men, or you're talking about models? Sorry.
No, historical army lists. Greeks, Romans, barbarians, Germans.
Historical army lists using Kings of War rules.
Ancient King of War.
No? That's interesting. It's an interesting idea. I think, you know what, I think I'll take this idea and ask, you know, maybe there's an interest from the companies here, you know, in Nottingham, there's, you know, Warlord, there's a lot of, you know, everybody's here. Maybe if, you know, if
Ronnie, Rick,
if Ronnie agrees, we could do something historical with Kings of War. Yeah, that's not a bad idea. Yeah, we'll talk about it. Thank you for the idea.
I need to play.
Dice que sí, que suena interesante y que te va a coger la idea que preguntará ahí, porque relativamente en Nottingham vive todo el mundo cerca de la miniatura, sí, se te lo pasará mucho. Y le va a preguntar y a ver qué se puede hacer, pero que le ha gustado la idea.
Dile que ya hemos visto vídeos por ahí jugando a Volaction en la casa de cierta persona, todos reunidos.
We have seen videos playing you playing Volaction in the house of certain person all together playing.
Sorry.
We saw videos playing you playing Volaction in the house of certain people all together. So
yes, these are Petsapoo videos, yes.
Tengo una preguntilla en plan broma. Cuando tú juegas contra Rick Priestley y uno de los dos se enfada, ¿dice eso de este es mi juego y me voy?
He asked if when you play with Rick Priestley and some of you get angry about the game, some of you say this is my game and goes simply away.
Not quite like that, but actually, yes, when we... The funny thing is that Bolt Action we wrote together, and when Rick is not there, I can say, oh yeah, this rule here that doesn't quite work, it's Rick. Rick wrote that rule, not me. And when I'm not there, Rick can say, yeah, this rule that doesn't work is Alessio's fault, yeah, no, it's not me, etc. But when we're both there, we sort of go, you wrote that rule. No, I'm pretty sure you wrote that rule. No.
I do. You don't? Why? Because in my game. Why? Where? One moment. This, here.
Dice que muchas veces cuando está en la letra, cuando están reunidos, pues cuando está jugando él, dice, no, esa regla la escribió Ricky y por eso no funciona. O sea, es cosa suya. Después, cuando está Ricky y no está él, pues dice Rick, no, esa regla la ha escrito Alessio y no funciona. Eso es cosa suya, es problema suyo. El problema real es cuando están los dos que empiezan a decirse que no, tú escribiste esa regla. No, yo recuerdo que tú fuiste en verdad que escribiste esa regla. Digo, no, estoy seguro que fuiste tú. Y hay ese tipo de
es la extraña pareja. Oh. Bueno, entonces vamos a hablar ya de Loca.
Yes, thank you, yes.
Que Loca acaba de salir a las tiendas, o ya es inminente que llegue a las tiendas, y además Alessio ha ampliado el universo jugable de Loca la semana pasada con la noticia de que iba a hacer el tarot, aunque Alessio me lo dijo hace ya varias semanas, pero en la noticia la dio en Facebook. Me gustaría saber un poquito cómo se juega ese tarot, si es un tarot puro y duro o tiene algo fantástico del mundo de Loca.
Vale, yo voy a traducir. Loca is coming to stores shortly, we can say almost now. So, some weeks ago also Alessio hinted to a new game or new game system, Loca Tarot. Obviously, we know about a bit longer about that, but from some weeks we are talking about Loca. Is ahí se me ha ido la pregunta, Julio, perdóname.
Que si es un tarot tradicional o tiene alguna reminiscencia fantástica del universo de.
Vale. He's asking if it's a traditional tarot or it has something to do with the Loca universe somehow.
Yes, so definitely. The Tarot of Loca, which is coming to Kickstarter very, very soon, and we'll talk about that later, but has, you know, like in Tarot or in playing cards, there are four suits. Yeah, there's always four suits. I don't know, in Tarot, instead of being spades, hearts, diamonds, and clubs, In Tarot would be coins, swords, cups, and clubs again. But the World of Loca has four elements at war. So immediately we went, okay, that sounds perfect. So what happens is the four suit of cards are actually elemental cards. So there is Earth, and you got the Ace of Earth, one, so which is one, then 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 of Earth, and then you have the Jack of Earth, which looks quite closely to the pawn of the chess pieces, the dwarf, the Earth guy, and then you have the Knight, because Tarot has knights as well as jacks and queens and kings, has got four face cards, four figures, so actually you go Jack, Knight, Queen, King, which are all kind of chess pieces as well. They look like the chess pieces, which is beautiful because you have the elemental in the cards and the pieces which look like the chess pieces and the figures. So actually the four suits are very Loca. Of course, Tarot, on top of this, has also what they call the Major Arcana. The Major Arcana are effectively the fifth element. They are, you know, like, they are the fifth, the one above, the one that rules them all. In fact, it is the gods. It's the gods and demigods of the world of Loca. Like we hinted in the Loca board game, where we have the queen of the fifth element. You know, so there's all these mystical creatures that are not one of the five elements, one of the four elements, they are the fifth element, the ruling element. And the major arcana are more similar to the traditional major arcana, just because I love the old traditional tarot, you know, the hermit, the wheel of fortune, the hanged man, the magician. There's all these elements in it, and so they are those cards, but have been slightly made more fantasy and less Christian, less, you know, so it's a bit more generic fantasy. So, you know, because we don't want to offend sensibilities and stuff. So it's very fantasy, but they are the same type of cards. And I can show you some examples maybe as we speak, if I can manage how to work out the screen share. Oh, actually, do you want to translate what I said before we do
that? Yes, no problem. Dice que sí, y muy, muy pronto va a haber un Kickstarter. Jolín, que se me ha ido el nombre.
De Loca
Tarot.
De Tarot.
Yeah, it's called Tarot of Loca.
Tarot of Loca. Y que va a tener un aspecto bastante tradicional. Va a tener cuatro palos, igual que el antiguo. Tarot tiene cuatro palos en sí, los arcanos menores, que pueden ser copa, oro, espada y bastos. Y en el mundo de Loca, pues se va a adaptar a los cuatro elementos y la verdad que encaja muy, muy bien. El tema va a ser que va a haber cada uno de los elementos. Estará el as de tierra, el as de fuego, después estará el uno de tierra, el dos de tierra, el tres de tierra, el cuatro de tierra, hasta llegar al peón de tierra. Hay una diferencia que es, han añadido el caballero y así, de esa forma, pues consigue tener todo el conjunto de Loca ahí metido, que sería pues peón, caballero, reina y rey. Y la verdad que le da un aspecto muy chulo, eso personalmente. Después también van a trabajar en el tema de los arcanos mayores, y el tema de los arcanos mayores van a utilizar al quinto elemento. El quinto elemento es el elemento que está sobre todos ellos. Ya había algunas pistas locas respecto a eso, como la reina del quinto elemento, y serán todos criaturas místicas y dioses. A él le gusta muchísimo el tarot clásico, el diseño del tarot clásico, así que los arcanos mayores serán muy, pero que muy parecidos al tarot tal como lo conocemos. Sin embargo, va a estar más ambientado en fantasía para intentar no ofender a la gente pues que maneja el tarot y demás, sino va a tener una aproximación más fantástica y quitando toda la reminiscencia cristiana que pueda tener.
Mm-hmm. Pregunta. ¿Qué?
Show you some pictures?
Yes. Sí, okay. ¿Qué tamaño aproximado piensas que va a tener las cartas, Alessio?
What size do you think it will have to cost, Alessio?
The traditional tarot size. I mean, okay. The tarot in the market. Of course, there's hundreds and hundreds, thousands of type of tarot cards. A lot of them are very arty, and they tend to be used for either just for collection, or people use them for divination and stuff like that. But there also exists a type of tarot which is the French tarot, which is played in France, and the cards are very similar to normal playing cards. So if I, you know, this would be the size of them, and that, you know, looks like a playing card. The only difference is, of course, that then you have in the suit, you also have knights, which you normally don't have in tarot, like that. For example, is one of the face cards. You have a knight, which is not a traditional, mm-hmm. not in playing cards. And then you have the major arcana. But in this playing card of tarot, all the character of the old tarot is gone, and it's been replaced by a simple, plain, kind of generic scene from La Belle Époque. So it's lost the evocative side of it, and has become very practical, because basically you see there's a number on each corner. So it becomes something that is very usable. You know, you use it in your hand, you can have it like this, but it's not very evocative. So that is, and this is a game, it's a card game, which is similar to Bridge, similar to Whist. Bridge, I think, is the best example because it's most known across the world. But then, of course, there are the old tarot, the ones that are very evocative, the ones that actually are, you know, the ones like, this is an example of an old Marseille-style tarot, where actually things look like that. Mm-hmm. And these are very cool. These have a lot of medieval feeling to them. But the drawback with these is it's very difficult to play using them. Because instead of having, you know, I showed you the nine of diamonds or clubs or everything, and instead of having those, you have cards that look like this. And suddenly, you know, there's no numbers in the corners, so holding them in your hand becomes very difficult because, you know, what am I holding? I don't quite know. I have a lot of funky stuff, but I don't know. So what we are trying to do with Loka is to get the best of both. So, sorry, I'll let you translate that again.
No problem. Vale, pues como el tamaño que como nos ha enseñado va a ser más o menos el tamaño de carta normal. De hecho, hay un tarot que es el tarot francés, que es el primero que nos ha enseñado, que ya ha perdido un poquito de la reminiscencia antigua, pero ya se ha vuelto muy jugable con los números en las cuatro esquinas, bastante fácil de ver. Los arcanos mayores son unas escenas, basta con su numerito y demás. No tiene, ha perdido lo evocativo, lo bonito del tarot clásico. Y de hecho, esas cartas se usan mucho para jugar juegos que se pueden, pues, la Brisca, son juegos que se encajan muy, muy bien para ese tipo de cartas. Luego también tenemos el tarot más viejo, más clásico, que es el segundo que nos enseñó, que tiene un aspecto más medieval, en el que se ve la muerte, que se ve la torre, y con esos dibujos muy bonitos. Y sin embargo, después, cuando vamos a las cartas normales, a las numeradas, se ven las monedas, y cuesta un poquito ver que no tiene número, y cuesta un poquito llevar a la hora de jugar. Así que el tarot de Loka será una cosa entre los dos, buscando pues el equilibrio para hacerlo que sea bonito y sobre todo jugable.
Interesante.
I can show you some of that because basically in Google Plus I think I can share my, is it a desktop I can share? I'm gonna try. Okay, let's try to share my desktop. Oh look, it's you. So what you could do,
I love it.
I give you an example.
Oh, okay.
So this would be a card. This is an Ace of Earth, and you can, before we get to the face card, the normal cards look like this. So you see, it's Earth. It's got numbers in the corners, and you can see the corner is still variable. This is an Ace, and then you get to the face card, the Knight, which looks familiar, a bit like the Knight in obviously in the chess pieces. The Jack, which again is the pawn from the chess piece, really, the Queen, and the King. So these are the pictures that are the actual face cards and the tarot. But then you, of course, that was Earth. Then you have here Air. Then you have Ice or Water, and then you have Fire. So these will become, that's a King, that's a Queen, that's a Knight, as you can see. But again, we're working on them, so obviously things are not finished. And here you have the Moon. So this is the Major Arcana. So this is one of the Major Arcana, the Moon, which again has the things in the corner. So it's playable. Wow. It's practical. Yes. It's practical, but it's also cool. So it's got both things.
Yes.
The Hermit.
Son muy elegantes, eh?
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Ralph is a great artist. He's very good. I really like his stuff. And then you have some cards like this one and this one, which are new. I added to make the game slightly different and unique. This is the back of the card.
Whoa.
Yes, it's very, very highly decorated. So I think now we can stop the screen share.
Yes.
Stop that. Yep. So how do we stop the screen share?
A ver si se va a colar algo que no se debería ver, ¿no?
I think the design looks really nice, and also something I think important for Loka the Tarot game, that we have the sensation it isn't from nowadays. It could be possibly something that someone could do 200, 300 years ago and draw it. And that is the design style that this causes us, or inspiring that it's quite possible someone 200 years ago could design this. Because
yeah,
really elegant, really nice, how all mixed together, and the colors and the shapes are also really good choosing.
Thank you. Yeah, we tried. We tried to make it look old. And for example, everything is hand-drawn. There is no digital going on. I mean, digital is used to double images and split images, but the actual artwork is all hand-drawn with traditional colors, traditional... I mean, Ralph will explain that better, obviously. It's a thing, but he didn't use any digital drawing. So it does feel like that. The icons are not perfect. It's not a perfect circle because it's been hand-drawn. So it has that feeling of it. Yes,
That it was when we could see on the image and what it evokes. Dice que básicamente ha sido lo que es eso, lo que buscaban, colores que parezca antiguo y sobre todo que todos los dibujos han sido dibujados a mano. Es cierto que cuando ya se duplica la imagen, ya no, que esté eso hecho de forma digital, pero en original sí está dibujado a mano y coloreado a mano para mantener pues esa estética y ese estilo que estaban buscando para el juego. Ya en ese tema de todas formas de cómo lo ha pintado y coloreado, eso ya tendría que explicarlo Ralph como indica Alessio Cavatore, pero es cierto, eso es lo que busca.
Pues está muy chulo.
The game, we can talk about the game, as in you were asking how it plays. I said it's like Bridge, but Bridge is very sophisticated. It's kind of a difficult game. I mean, is complex. What I've done is I've taken the traditional tarot, the way they play it in France, which I think is the oldest way, the closest to the medieval way of playing it. And even that is still fairly complicated. It's similar to Bridge, really, because I think probably Bridge evolved from that kind of game. And I simplified it. I made it simple. The rules, I boiled them down to a whist level, something that basically you can play with your family. The idea is that, I played it with some guys. There's going to be a hangout tomorrow where, they show us playing it. And they basically, I taught them the game, 5 minutes. They started to play it. After the first time, they played it and learned it, and then they could play it. So it's very simple. But, like chess, there's even less rules than chess, even fewer rules, of course. But then, of course, the strategy of the... Because it's a team game. It's two players against two players, and you cannot speak with your teammate. So... The rules are simple. The game is extremely simple and playable by kids and enjoyable. But at the same time, obviously, it's very sophisticated in the strategy of it, which I think is the best game, really.
Vale. Para el juego, pues he elegido no quiero algo tan complicado como la brisca, sino estar buscando algo más sencillo y se basó en el juego, en el diseño del juego, a lo cómo se jugaba actualmente el tarot en Francia. Pero tampoco está utilizando ese tipo de regla porque ya muchos juegos se basaron ya en ese juego cuando salió más adelante y también es complicado de por sí. Así que elaboró más la regla para simplificarlo un poquito más y hacerlo accesible para toda la familia, para que pudiera jugar fácilmente cualquier persona y aprender en cuestión de minutos jugarlo. De hecho, yo creo entendido que van a ser una partida por Hanau y no cuesta mucho explicarle a la persona cómo funciona el juego y echarle la partida directamente. El juego es un juego simple para la hora de jugar, pero que tiene mucha estrategia después de fondo. Incluso tiene menos reglas que el ajedrez. Y además se juega por en equipo de dos, o sea, dos contra dos. Un juego que se juega en equipo.
There's one more thing, really, is that the art of this, I mean, I'm sure you've seen it, but what Ralph is doing, I find amazing, because I really like his stuff, because he illustrated Dungeons and Dragons, he illustrated Magic the Gathering, he illustrated, World of Warcraft, all sort of games, Talisman, Games Workshop stuff. He's done so much stuff that when you see his art, sometimes you go, oh, that was you. You did that. And you did that. And you did that too. And so he's a very talented guy. And he's actually trying this as something different because, as you notice, it's not modern style, as you said. It's ancient style. So it's flat colors, flat lines, but a lot of detail. So it's interesting for him, and he's really enjoying it, and he's making some really nice pieces. And basically, the Kickstarter is really... the Kickstarter is going to be pretty much to get me enough cash to pay him, because obviously, you know, he's a big artist, so he's expensive. So I really need to get the cash to pay him, and the Kickstarter is going to go out soon. So probably, I say Friday or Saturday, we have decided this week. And the one important thing to keep in mind, I guess, if I start with you to drop the message, is through the Kickstarter you can actually buy the original art that he did for this. So actually getting in first, because obviously there's only one of each piece that is done for the tarot, because it's the original. So actually getting in quick and getting those pieces will be an important thing of that Kickstarter, I think.
Mm-hmm. Vale. Bueno, nos empieza comentando que Raf es un artista muy bueno. Ha dibujado para Dragon y Mazmorra, ha dibujado para Magic el Encuentro, ha dibujado para WoW, el World of Warcraft, para Talismán. Y la relación es eso. ¿Tú has pintado eso? Sí, yo he pintado eso, vaya. Y nos denota que es una persona con una amplia gama de estilos y que ha dibujado muchísimo. Ahora mismo está dibujando el tarot de Loca, un diseño más plano, muy detallado, pero de colores planos, y que le están quedando un montón de bonito. Y de hecho, él mismo, el artista, pues está disfrutando esta variación en su portafolio, como quien dice, de ilustraciones que ha hecho. De hecho, también nos comenta Alessio que el Kickstarter en parte es para pagarle al ilustrador, ¿vale? Así que es muy importante la campaña esta y que va a salir esta semana sobre el viernes o el sábado. Esa es la idea inicial que tiene, sacarlo el viernes o el sábado. Y como adelanto, nos dice que el arte original será vendido en el Kickstarter. Cada una de las láminas será vendido y podrá cada uno buscar. Lógicamente solo habrá una copia de cada una, ya que es el original. Así que...
curioso.
Te pinta muy bien.
Pues sí. Dile si hay alguna cosa que quiere decir sobre Loca. ¿Algo más? O...
Alessio, is something else do you want us to you want hand to about Loca say that we haven't asked or?
Well, no, I mean you guys are the first to which I revealed so much, because obviously we're getting close to this and I'm getting excited and I cannot stop talking about it. But thank you. I think we've done a great amount of detail and images and stuff that have never been seen before. So no, thank you for the occasion to do this, for the chance.
Dice que no, pero que prácticamente ha sido en el medio donde más cosas ha dicho, sobre todo porque está muy cercana a la fecha y no puede dejar de hablar de Loca, está muy emocionado con el proyecto y que muchas gracias por el espacio y el tiempo que hemos recibido.
Tenemos que... Alessio, hay tres cuestiones o tres promesas que quiero que sacarte. Una es que cuando esté el tarot de Loca, juegues con Alejandro por Hanou para demostrar que se puede jugar por Hanou al tarot de Loca.
He wants to ask you two or three things. One is that when the tarot of Loca is out, that you play actually a live game with me to show people that it's actually possible to play through Hanou.
Cool.
Vale. Sí. Segunda. Dentro de un tiempo, cuando yo ya haya grabado varias partidas de Loca, el juego de mesa, hacer un Hanout sobre Loca, sobre cuestiones y futuro y lo típico.
He says also that after he played Loca, to make a Hanout to tell about the game itself, the mechanic, how it works and so, and the future about this game.
Y la tercera promesa, que si quieres no digas nada ahora, es para hacer un Hanout dentro de un tiempo para hablar qué pasa con Warpath ahora que ha salido Deathzone, y Deathzone es mucho más grande que Warpath. La gente en Málaga me pregunta qué pasa con Warpath.
You don't have to answer to this. But the third promise is about to talk about Warpath, because nowadays the Deathzone is much bigger than Warpath, and the people of Malaga is asking to him what's happening with Warpath, what's happening in the future.
The moment I find out, I certainly be happy to talk about it, but at the moment the real answer is don't quite know.
Dice que ahora mismo no sabe.
Pues que en el futuro que mañana pregunte Ronnie. What's happening with the Warpath?
Yeah, we need to talk about that too. Yeah.
Okay. Yo creo que ya ha estado buena la entrevista. Señores, Kino War es un juegazo. Loca. Parece un buen juego. Ya lo probaremos en Forge Dead Punk y grabaremos partidas. Y deseamos que profundamente que Warpath tenga un buen futuro, equiparable al de Kino War.
Vale. He says it has been nice interview. King of War is a great game. Also, it's Loca, and we are really excited to talk about it in the new future. Sí.
Yo soy un fanático de King of War. Casi todas las semanas grabo una partida de King of War en el canal, para el canal.
He's a fanatic about King of War. He records almost every week one game session of Kings of War. We put it online. We have already 7. The 8 will be coming really shortly. I think tomorrow maybe it's finished. And he's really also excited to talk in the near future about Warpath and what's happening with this game. So,
yes. I have a few ideas, but I don't think I can talk about it. So.
Yes.
I know. Bueno, pues muchas gracias por estar otra vez con nosotros, Alessio. Siempre es un placer hablar con un maestro. Bueno, si Alejandro quiere preguntar algo y ya acabamos.
No, yo no tengo nada que preguntar, más o menos está todo cubierto y cualquier cosa de todas formas siempre de vez en cuando pues Alessio siempre le escribo por ahí, si tenemos nuestra comunicación, así que no pasa nada, no hay nada sinceramente que crea que se debería de preguntar.
Bueno,
nada, thank you very much, Alessio, from me. It's a pleasure to talk with a master like you, and for us it's always a pleasure to offer you this opportunity to talk to the gamer community and have this quite an hour of fun talking with you and becoming some kinds of the future of Mantic and of Riverhorse. So thank you very much.
And it's always great to be here, to be able to talk to you guys and talk to the community and to be called a master. That's nice. Yeah. I wish more people called me that.
Ay, Alessio, te recuerdo que nos debes un hangout sobre Volaction.
Yes.
Te lo recuerdo.
Yes, we will do that.
Well, he says for the English committee that Alessio, you own us and hangout about Volaction. We actually have Volaction, Julio and I have English and he has German. So I think as maybe beginning next year, we will begin to make also battle reports like we will make of Kings of War, of Bold Action. And we are really really excited about it. We have actually also the one English Bold Action rulebook and one Spanish.
Of course.
Rulebook.
See the Spanish.
Translated. So we will make more videos and talk about the game. Miniature looks really great.
The Volaction in Spanish.
Mm.
It's a really great edition.
I've seen it, yeah.
Es muy similar a la inglesa.
It's really similar to the English one. I have it. 1 second. I have only to stretch. So, have it here. So, we are really excited. And you know that Volaction is a really good, nice game. But I would really like to build the miniatures how they should be on my army. So I have really to read the book carefully, think about what I want to make and put it together. Because it's really nice army to show what it's really equipped on every miniature. the options are so many and so amazing that it's
there is really a lot nice. Yeah.
And it's also really nice having the possibility of playing your games through different companies, and a lot more than people may think that you are involved. We are quite missing some games. We are missing maybe Wild West Exodus or some other sort that you worked also.
Well, the All Quiet on the Martian Front is just about to start shipping as well.
Yes. So there are a lot of games that you are involved, more than people knows. And that's really always fun.
Yeah, All Quiet on the Martian Front by Alien Dungeon is actually another one that I've done together with Rick Priestley. So we actually, again, we can start accusing each other. And
Yes. I think that Rick's friendship is that one that makes you, even in your fun time or when you are not supposed to work, to begin actually work and having 2 or 3 hours writing something down, and when you were quite working on your game, right, Rick?
Yeah.
That kind of situation.
Rick is a great guy, absolutely.
Alessio, para cuando hagamos el handout de Volation, deberías de invitar a Rick Priestley para que él no pudiera decir que esas reglas las has escrito tú.
I will translate it for the English community. He says that when we make the video about bold action, you should invite Rick Priestley in this panel, so he could actually say that you were written by you.
I think we shall do that. When we do the bold action hangout, I'll make sure that Rick is actually in the same room as me, so it will be the two of us.
Okay.
Well, that will be really, really great. So.
Sería realmente asombroso tener con nosotros a la extraña pareja.
Okay.
Thank you guys.
Thank you.
Pues
vale, cortamos entonces, ¿no?